Hello guys, welcome back to another episode of ProView. Thanks for your support and your encouragement. And today we have a special guest. Before that, let me welcome my co-host Amit Rane.
Thank you, Amit. Thank you, Monsa.
Today we have a good friend of us coming and explaining to us about his photography. And he lives underwater more than he lives over the land. Welcome, Mr. Nandakumar.
Welcome, Nanda, sir.
Good morning, friends. Thank you so much, Mohan, sir. And thank you, Amit, sir, for giving this great opportunity for me to be you with you people and share a little bit of what I know about the less seen rather than an unseen world. I say less seen because there are still people who know it better than me, and there are still people who know things going on underwater. And I'm sure Amit sir knows many of them. But thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. So it's my precious moments to share with you guys.
In fact, Nanda sir, it's all our pleasure. To be very frank, you know, me as a photographer, when I do my wildlife photography, my landscape photography, underwater photography always remains a mystery for me, because you know how to go, where to go, how to contact, what gear one should use. You know, all these questions comes to my mind, and I always refrain myself doing that. So I think I need your help today to make us understand how easy or how complicated this entire photography genre is. So it's all yours. But before we start, Nanda sir, I just wanted to ask you one question. From a businessman to now a full-time a photographer and a tour operator, right? Nature Extreme is your brand, right?
Yeah.
So how the transformation happens?
Okay, like, see, I started my career very early, somewhere in 1987. And I have been on a money-making mission, because I had a vision that one fine day when I retire, I should not turn back towards my money-making session again and spend more time. And luckily, with the family support and well-wishers like all of you around. So my money-making session ended somewhere after 23 years of career in 2010. That is when, 2010 April, I decided that I will remove my suits and blazers and the leather shoes, and then got into my first Aman shoot camera, and I went to Ladakh. That was in May 2010. And I came back from Ladakh, but I realized that the man in me is not exactly a man, it's rather a fish. Because water has been my obsession rather since childhood, where my father used to beat me up blue and white, and I used to still go into the water and escape from him. So I was a good swimmer, I was a university diver on the dive boats and everything, but water was always there with me. And luckily, I got an opportunity to get into scuba diving course, because one of my colleagues' son paid the fees, and he got so nervous that he said, I'm not going. And then I took over that course. And incidentally, let me share one more thing with you. That was the time when I paid the money and came home, and my elder son was, he has stopped. My elder son has been more a close friend to me than a son. He's a friend first and son next. And he's talk, everything was changed. And next day morning, my wife told, he's angry with you. I asked why. No, he wanted to join scuba diving. I said, it's very expensive. He can't do that. No. And he did a hunger strike and joined me. That was the actually luckiest part which happened to me. I will explain to you later how it happened. So both of us went. And another funny thing, what happened, I did all the theory course and all. And genuinely, the way I was doing when in my earlier exam, I copied from my son and passed the theory exams. So, and the theory exam was over and we went to the sea. This was May 18th somewhere in 2010, and we went to the water, and I was so nervous in the sea. There was my first instructor was Mr. Sajindra Das, who was a project head in Oracle, and he was a part-time scuba dive instructor, and he took me to the water, and I told, I have BP, sugar, that, this, all stories what I can tell, and told him that I cannot dive today. And he was really concerned. And then my son took him to the side and told, he's only acting the drama best he can. He just want to avoid the diving. And he just told, where your BCD and where the entire equipment and sit and relax. Mm-hmm. Try to meditate for 10 minutes and look towards the sea. You'll be all right. I next or big kick on my ass and I was in the water. And that day, till day, luckily no one kicks me. I kick myself and I am in the water. So that is how it started. After doing around 10-20 dives, I realized that whatever I am coming out, like for example, when I tell you people that I saw a shark which was 10 times bigger than me, I saw a manta ray which braised my body with a very lovely touch and other things, people used to listen to me and also laugh at me. Close friends used to tell, "Tu aise hi bak bak karta rahe, kuch to dikhata nahi." And then I realized, okay, I need a camera. That is when first ever camera of my life. Just to tell you people, before that, I never even knew, other than spelling of the camera, I knew nothing till 2010. So I took a Canon aim and shoot G7, I think, if I remember right. And then went into underwater again. And October that year, I did my advanced open water course in Maldives and took some images and came out and realized images are as bad as they can be. And that is when another few months happened. So 2011, June, I decided that, no, I have to take a photography course. That was the time when I think Mohan sir can watch me. If you go to any Google and type photography in Bangalore, the first thing comes BP. Yeah, I met our friend, unfortunately, who is not anymore. Mr. Ashish Parmar and Aparna, they were my first day gurus. And I went to the first safari. Mohan sir, another truth to share with you. You will be very happy to listen to this. My first camera was a D7200 Can Nikon with the lens, kit lens and another lens. And then I went, but by the time I completed the course and learned photography, DPW has convinced me that Nikon is the bad camera, worst camera you can possibly take. And they converted me into a Canon man. Now today, with so much of equipment for underwater and all. So later on, the journey continued from underwater 70. I went to 70 Mark II. Then I have 5D Mark III, 5D SR. Then, and unfortunately, or rather fortunately, I met all the friends like you. And I got stuck to nature, wildlife, and underwater. And I always suggest people, boss, pehle ek cheez select karo, either do wildlife photograph or go underwater. Nahi to na idhar ka na udhar kar rahe jaoge, jaise main hu aaj. So that's what happened to me. That's a brief about myself. So that's it. That's how I started.
And I still remember our first meeting in Kabini. Hope you remember that.
Yes, you sir, came 2013. All yes. The three brothers with two more friends of mine. And I think if I am right, Mr. Arun or Sudhir Shivaram introduced me to you people that day. So
that was our first day. But yeah. I told him, yeah, you are an underwater king. How are you there in the jungle? I think that's what I told you first.
Sir, jungles are the only places I see the emperors like you. So otherwise, underwater, mein toh, I will see only fish and other mammals. You people are my inspiration who are available only outside now, sir.
Thank you, Nanda.
Yeah. So, without any further delay, Nanda, sir, we would like to see that the entire khazana of yours, which yes, you sir. Got underwater.
Now, this is what my friends, even underwater, calls me, that I am a nomad. Because in underwater, there is nothing like you do something sane or anything. All you do is you be one among those animals and become an animal and live your manlyhood and be what you are. This is my full gaze. And to share, this was my very first trip to the place called Murdeshwar in Karnataka, which is still happens to be the best, one of the top five destinations in India for the scuba diving. This is where I started my journey as a scuba diver in 2010. And I'm missing my scuba diving instructors here. There is one person here, Mr. Rahul, who is one of the instructors with me now. And the journey started here. And now this photo still happens to be my most favorite photo, because after a few dives when I took the camera, this was the first ever click I took. This is a grouper fish, and the guy was inquisitive enough to look at me with the camera and posed me for a few seconds. And this still happens to be a very close to my heart image. And just to go further, like as I was explaining you guys, this was my first trip to Maldives in October 2010 to do my advanced underwater course, so open water course, where I became certified diver to dive up to 40 meters. Now, to explain something about this liveaboards are nothing but live-on boats, where general trend all over the world today is you will check in on a particular day like Saturday morning. And from that day, since the last day of your trip, which happens to be next Saturday afternoon, you will be on the ocean. Zero contact with the land to the extent possible, unless the ship gets into some problem or we have to pick up some supplies in some of the small islands. So you are in the ocean, the high tides, the low tides, the currents, and everything for you is the blue. It's all around blue. And the best part is you can dive wherever you want. Like when we dive from the land-based destinations where you have to go in the boat and there are limited choices for your dive destination. But whereas in the liveaboard, you will go to where the fishes are there and you can make your ship boat stop there and spend time diving and coming out. That was one of the memorable experience. After that, till date, I have done around 22 liveaboard trips to various destinations with repeated 3 trips to a destination called Raja Ampat, which is my most favorite diving destination even today, at least among what I have seen, because I have not seen still the best like Galapagos or Hawaii or some of the Mexican or South American sites. But Raja Ampat, even after seeing all those things, I have been to Fiji, I had been to a few places in New Zealand, and I have seen far away country like Tonga, but still Raja Ampat is my favorite. So that is where I have done more than 3 liveaboard trips. This is one of my photo clicked by one of my dive buddies. And this is where towards the end of the dive, where my wife, which I actually a camera is not with me. I will have the liberty of posing like this. And now let me go through some of my images. This is one of the macro images which I have clicked in Andaman, which is another best destinations in for scuba diving in India. So this is a Nemo, Red Nemo.
Can you tell me what is the lens you use for this?
Yes, sir. Actually, presently my camera is Canon 5DSR. And to tell you a little bit further about that, Canon 5DSR I use because it gives me a very high resolution images with better megapixel. I don't know whether D850, what is the megapixel you use in that. But this is a 51 megapixel camera where a full frame image, which I'm showing you now, this is a full frame image in with a lens 100mm. And this image, before processing, see raw image itself will be around 100 MB. Mm-hmm. The advantage for me is when I come to further few more images, I will show you, I can go to the 10% of the image and enlarge it and process it. It will be crystal clear. And another advantage I have with the 5DSR is focusing is very fast. And it will save a lot of time, because basically to talk about the time incidentally, a normal diver underwater will have 60 minutes with one tank of 12 liters of air. Whereas for with the lungs, low lung capacity people like me, I have a little bit problem with my lungs, and generally I spend 30 to 40 minutes. So that goes to say how precious time is. So that goes to say how important a proper camera on this thing is. My lenses mount, sir, for the wide angle, I use generally 815mm and 8mm almost 120 degree view. All around wide angle, and 815, it's a variable lens. And then I also have a 15mm variable lens, I mean the fixed lens. And then generally for my macro, I use 100mm, sir. And for 100mm, I also have a plus 10 extender where you can, for example, if this is the fish we are shooting, I can focus on the eye of that fish, which itself is hardly around 2 inches in size. I can focus on the eye of that fish with 100 mm plus 10 magnifier. Only thing for that, you have to be very buoyant and experienced underwater. So sometimes I do get some good shots with magnifier. So that's about my camera, sir. And my housing is a, there are many housings available by CNC, Ecolite, Nauticam like that. I am with Nauticam and I use a 9000 lumen standalone light for my videos. And I have two Inon Z240 strobes, which are available with a variable lighting settings. This is my setup. And always I will have one Olympus TG6 Tough in my jacket, underwater jacket, as a standby. And also I carry one Sony 4K camera for the videos.
Thank you.
That's it. And now to next of the images. This is another memo which was clicked in Thailand. This is a pink skunk memo they call. And this is one of my favorite images from Raja Ampat, a school of surgeon fishes. These fishes are called surgeons generally because their fins are so sharp that if you happen to touch, I mean, a fish passes through your hand, it can cut your hand by few mm. So the sharp fins they have, they are called surgeon fishes because of that. And this is another yellow striped snapper school, again from my favorite place, Raja Ampat. And now this is a place called, there is a place called Sipadan in Malaysia. Sipadan happens to be one of the UNESCO heritage sites where they strictly allow only 40 divers, scuba divers per day. So the problem will be you have to go and stay in an island like called Mabul. And there you have to take the permit. If you dive for in Mabul for 4 days, they will give you 1 day in Sipadan. So I almost spent around 13 days in Mabul and got around 3-4 days in Sipadan. So unfortunately that time the weather was also not very cooperative with me. Otherwise this fish school, the circle, what you're seeing here, you will see the full hollowness and in between the divers also, like Dheeraj has some very good images like that in the, in between the fishes, but unfortunately I could not get Dheeraj in those fishes with my camera. So that is the luck part. And this is a school of jackfish, what we call, from Sipadan. And now this is night dive in scuba diving is a very passionate thing for many people. And I love the night dives for the simple reason that the big predators or pelagics, what we call, they come out in the night hunting for their food. And that never mean that they try to harm you or anything, because their concentration will be their own appetite. So they are in search of food and you will be like an alien for them. And they will get a little bit inquisitive. Here, this diver who is from a boat called Mermaid, and this diver's name was Joey. Joey was the short, and this guy was 83 year old when I dived with him. And he was like, almost, I could not judge myself whether the shark was faster than him or he was faster than the shark, to just to tell you about his efficiency underwater. And that goes to say that age is not a bar for scuba diving. The oldest scuba diver today is 96th birthday. He dived for something around 42 minutes, if I am right. So that is only to request Mohan sir that. Mohan sir, still you have time for a second run underwater.
Sure.
And Amit sir, you too.
And you took me to Thailand for some snorkeling.
Yeah, that was one of those nice moments. I still have the images, Mohan sir. With your permission only, I will release. But otherwise, they will be in the hot desk. So this was a night dive where you are seeing that nursing sharks. In particularly, there are one or two dive sites in Maldives where we find these nursing sharks in tens and tens of scuba divers, that they will come, look at you, and they will catch you with their fin and circle around you. That experience is something which only one someone can experience to talk about it, and it is beyond words. So this is one such image from Maldives in the night dive. And this was another experience I had in Fiji. Just to share one thing, we all know the name Dhrithiman Mukherjee. Now, I went to Fiji and we had to postpone our flight for some reason by 3 days. And then we decided that we will go for the diving. Then we went to the resort and we notified one dive center and I went there. And the dive center lady, she registered me everything. She asked, India? Yes. She held me by hand and literally dragged me for 300 yards. I want to show you something. Come, come, come. And she knocked a door. The door opens. Who is standing there? Dhrithiman Mukherjee in front of me. That was my one of the greatest moments where I had the privilege to spend 2 nights, 3 days with him. And we did around 6 or 8 dives together. And that guy is unbelievable. I'll tell you, underwater. And what I did in 800 dives, I'm damn sure he has learned it in 8 dives and did it. So that goes to say how the comparison is between a legend and a normal man. So this was one of the pictures which I have taken sitting next to Mr. Dhrithiman Mukherjee. So goes to say without saying, he's one of my very close image. And here, the bull sharks comes to feed. And generally, seeing a bull sharks in an open sea is a very rare thing, not much. But here, they come in numbers. Like you can see, there are one is there on the top, and one is here, and one in the background. There were many of them. And the moment was really memorable. This was from Fiji. And this is another best of the experience of mine. This is a baby humpback whale from a place called Tonga in Oahu. And there, that is, Tonga is the only place in the world, to the best of my knowledge, where you can swim with these little giants without disturbing them and in a normal temperature water of 29 degrees. Otherwise, you see a lot of humpback whales in Arctic. Monsar must have seen the humpback whales jumping even in Svalbard also. What, Monsar?
Yes, yes, yes.
But there, you can, at the same time, we know how difficult it is to get into that water and swim along with these guys. But whereas these guys, they do their transit from all the way from Arctic to Tonga for breeding and feeding, and we find lot of humpback whale families there. Like at one particular dive, we saw 3 mothers, 2 babies, and 2 males. So that was a wonderful moment. This is humpback whale from Tonga. And this is another picture from Lakshadweep, which is again India's one of the premier dive sites. So this is a couple of white tip sharks. And another, my favorite subject underwater, green turtle. And this is a, this thing, what is that? No, this is a green turtle only, yeah. And now this is another image from the island called Bunaken. This image has won me a few awards also. And at that particular dive, the weather was also not supportive. So the water current was too much. And the dive guide showed me this turtle sitting on a moving branch of fans. And the moment was so bad that I could not focus on the image. Then I could have focused on the turtle. And dive guide told me to hold on for a minute, went out and bought another dive guide where both of them were holding me tight so that I could concentrate and get some wonderful images. This image, I must have printed more than 50 copies of this image still as a gift or as a sale, and it has been published in few magazines also, and it has won 3 awards also for me.
Wow.
So this is one of my favorite images from a place called Bunaken in Indonesia. And this is another image. This is what, Monsar, I was explaining you how the images come in 8 mm. And this turtle was just around 3 or 4 inches away from me. Mm-hmm. And this is where my camera needs work. And this is one image from Maldives. Maldives is known for manta rays. Manta rays are the most gentle rays available around the world. And if they become comfortable with you, you can spend full dive with them. Many of them actually, but unfortunately, I have been unlucky with the manta rays. I have never seen more than 6 or 8 in a single dive. But otherwise, there are people who have spent time with 50, 60 manta rays on a single dive in Maldives. That happens in the season between June and August. This is another image from Maldives only, where you see my fellow diver also trying to, and this image I'm trying to show because to show how comfortable they are to come so near to the divers and still not feel threatened. So that goes to say that if you don't disturb them, how can you enjoy the closeness with the sea creatures? This is another from the night ship, this night trip only. This is a stingray from Maldives. And this is from a place called Palauwe in Malaysia, Indonesia. And this is a giant moray eel. And these guys, though they look so ferocious, but at the same time, they are totally harmless. And if you see their jaws, hopefully I will have another image where I can show you the jaws. They have inward jaws like this, where one jaw will come behind another. Like there, behind there is one more jaw. Like the problem with this is like, Amit sir, if you know little bit about pythons, like if python has an inward movement and anything coming out from the python is difficult because the jaw will lock it.
Yes.
So that's what happens with moray eels also. And the problem, some few of the over-inquisitive or careless divers, they try to kindle with these people. These moray eels are so inquisitive, like if you start shaking your fingers, they will move their head also along with your finger, like the way a cobra does it. And these people become so inquisitive, suddenly the moray eel feels that you are the finger is a food. And by mistake, if the finger has gone into its mouth, what you will get only hand, not the fingers. So that is to say that how careful you should be with these gentle creatures also. This is moray eel from Palauwe. And this is a multi-decker hard rock coral from Raja Ampat. And this hard rock coral, there was one particular dive where I have seen two people were diving with very sophisticated camera equipment and video recording. The most unfortunate thing they did was, you can see this hard rock coral block, how many kind of fishes it's hosting.
Yeah.
Actually, once I entered near that, many fishes have moved away. But these people, they have spent sufficient time to see that all the fishes accumulate and they cleaned. But the worst happened next. After they finished their photo session, they kicked all the corals, broke them and went. And their idea was, a beautiful image, what I got, somebody else should not get.
Oh God!
Unfortunate thing is, this coral to grow to this stage, it might have taken decades, easily more than 4 or 5 decades. But for them to destroy it, has taken less than a minute. So this is where I say that anybody who gets into underwater, please don't touch anything. Don't destroy anything. Your memories should be in your brain or your hard disk. But for God's sake, let that survive for our future generations. And hard corals are the biggest banks of many minerals for the fishes, which will make them live longer. This is another colorful image from Fiji. When we are not diving with the bull sharks, in Fiji, what happened? One day they will give you diving with bull sharks in some dive sites. And next day they will take you to the other dive sites where colorful corals are there. And Fiji is considered to be one of the best places for the colorful soft corals and hard corals.
Nanda sir, one question from my side.
Yes, sir.
See, you carry multiple lenses and maybe yes, multiple cameras, but it is very difficult to carry multiple cameras at the same time. Or you carry multiple cameras when you go down?
No, sir. The problem with underwater is, like, with due apologies, I'll take Sanjit sir's name. When he goes for the safari, he will have 800, 400, 300, 200, 74, 200 and 2470. Sure. But in underwater, your restriction is only to, because the facility itself, your housing itself will have a limitation of either you carry a macro or you carry a wide angle camera. Yeah. So you will invariably have to carry one lens.
So my question comes from, So whenever you go for a dive, so instructor will always tell you, okay, this is a, there is a chance for shoot a beautiful wide angle shot.
Or let me explain that, sir. For the way, for example, when someone is going to, let us say, Satal, you know how many species of bird, what lens you have to carry, and your naturalist locally explains that. Like that in scuba diving also, there are local experts who know what is, for example, I go to a place called, you know, I was just talking about a place called Bunaken. And from Bunaken, there is 1.5 hour drive. There is a place called Lembeh. In Lembeh, all your wide angle lenses are totally useless, because in Lembeh, what you get is all macro objects, macro light, where sometimes even 100 mm camera will become big. So you need, you want to have an extender or adapter, what I call, plus adapter. So that is one of the basic limitations for underwater scuba divers. But otherwise, there are people who are professionals who go with, like one photographer go with four assistants who are all carrying four different cameras, and he will have the privilege. But that goes to say the kind of money one has to shell down. But what I do, as I was telling, that I will have this one basic big camera, 5DSLR. Otherwise, I will have an aim and shoot, which is a Canon, this is Olympus PG6. Which comes handy for me. Like, for example, if I'm shooting something wide angle with 15 mm, and I cannot shoot anything macro, then this camera comes handy in me. So my guide will hold my big camera, then I will try to shoot something, at least for the record purpose. Otherwise, for the still memorable moment, there is our video, which I told you I will always carry handy, a video also. Like when I explain about wide angle lenses, see this particular image, what I'm showing from Raja Ampat, this fan, C fan, is a Gregorian fan, what we call. This fan width maybe around more than 5-6 meters. Mm-hmm. And you can see a big wide area of the thing. This was shot with 15 mm length, covering a huge area and trying to concentrate. And I used two strobes where, by mistake, one of the strobe was coming closer to the right side of the image where it is overexposed. So this is where the talent and placing of the strobes properly and then adjusting your exposure. So this is one of my photos from wide angle camera in Raja Ampat. And now I will show you some of the wide angle camera. There is a place called Tubataha in Philippines. Now, if someone Googles about Tubataha, somewhere around 2000, this place was totally washed out and there was zero amount of the corals and other things. But it was explained that Philippine government with some NGOs and the local researchers has taken initiative to declare this as a protected area, and their effort paid off. And last I clicked, this image was somewhere in 2018 May. So looking at this image, you can understand if man makes up his mind what he can create. This is a full effort by, I mean, my knowledge is very less and the time is also very less here to explain how Tubataha got transformed by itself into a World Heritage Site from a totally washed out site like what Great Barrier Reef today. So if that can happen in Tubataha, I feel with little help of the nature and a little maximum effort of a human being, we can convert even Great Barrier Reef into a colorful area again. So that is where the conservation has to play its role. Tubataha again is open for a very limited period in the year, somewhere between March and April. And you can go there only by lure boats. You cannot stay in any resorts and dive. So those lure boats are also very limited and the experience will be unbelievable. This was my last lure boat trip I did in 2018 May. After that, I have done some land trips, and 2019, everybody know what happened. Sorry, 2020, everybody knows what happened. Now, let me go through some of the macro images which I have clicked. This is from the place called Palauwe. This is a porcelain crab on sea anemones. And sea anemones cannot be touched by hand because they will have some chemicals which is poisonous and which will damage your fingers and create injuries like that. And these porcelain crabs take shelter on these anemones and live together. And now this is one of those crabs from underwater. Clicked. It's a quite big crab of around, say, 6 to 8 inches. But this was clicked with a macro lens, trying to focus on its eyes and the mouth. And this is, again, a miracle of the nature, you can say. This is called mandarin fish. And this fish I have seen so far in only 4 places. One was in and one was in a place called Koror Island in Micronesia. And another noticeable feature of these fishes, they come out at the sunset time. So that means your diving has to be a sunset dive. Oh. And here, the male fish, 2 or 3 male fishes will dance continuously to attract one female. And the female, whomsoever is more attractive for her, this is the mating shot. And this mating can happen for very limited time. And in that, if you are lucky and if you could focus with their swift movement. So I don't say this is one of the best images, but the clarity and other things to the best of my satisfaction was there. And I was lucky to get them in a pair. Otherwise, single. I have a lot of single images where the male dancing or female hiding and looking at the male. I think, but this is the best moment of the life. This is called mandarin fish, which people say that this is the inspiration for all textile designers to design their designs. And beautiful. No doubt, it's a fact for me.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Yeah, fish. Thank you. And this is a crab which is called as a sponge crab. I mean, this crab has a very funny behavior where to escape from the predators, they will grab the sponge around them and make a shelter out of it. See, here on the top, you can see this giant crab having a sponge on its body. And over a span of time, this sponge will grow to such an extent that the weight of the sponge will make the crab crushing that weight, which you see in the next image here. The crab sponge has grown so much that crab has become only 50% of the pot. So that is another nature's wonder, where the surrounding growth becoming a shelter for the crab. And this is, many of you people will know this, this is cuttlefish. Mm-hmm. And this, all images are taken within a span of 1 minute from the same cuttlefish. And I need not have to explain you how good they are in changing their colors. And it will be a real memorable situation to watch them if they are a little bit aggressive or they are a little bit attentive, and when they are trying to escape, and they will change their colors so fast that even scientists have also could not find the 100% reason why it, how it happens at all. But that is the real nature's wonder beyond human comprehension. And now this is a very beautiful but the most dangerous octopus in underwater. This is called blue ring octopus. And it has been told that a blue ring octopus has sufficient poison to kill few people instantly. And the toxin released by blue ring octopus will be active and the man will be dead in minutes. So, only thing, our dive guides will take us to the destination where they locate a blue ring octopus, and they will take us near enough for them to this pose for us. And they will be normally a very bluish kind of a thing, and the rings available in a brownish color, which you are seeing around the blue color. But once they become little attentive of anything around them, the blue starts coming out. And when the more blue is there and they start coiling all their tentacles, that tells you that you have a few seconds to move away from them. Mm-hmm. And that's the time to go. So one of those lucky moments where the guy was resting coolly looking at us and I could get some images. And this is a flamboyant cuttlefish. And unfortunately, I could not show the videos. Flamboyant cuttlefish, it will be totally in black or brown in color. Huh? But once you approach them and show a little bit light to them, I don't know what kind of photosynthesis or whatever happens to them. The color, what they change is unbelievable. And they become very attentive. They hear the eye is open and the tentacles are open and it is ready to move out. Before that, I could click few images. And I have some beautiful videos also of this, which maybe in the time to come, I'll be able to share with you. And this is one of the most favorite subject of all the photographers who visit Lembe, particularly. This is an octopus, which is almost a size of little more than a golf ball. And the funny thing is, the moment they see you, and close themselves into sun fully. Actually, here at least it is open 10-20%. But there are some photographs I have where only the eyes will be seen, and you need some time to recognize that there is an octopus. And some careless people try to use their pointers and take out the top shell to make them open. But they are so adamant with their tentacles, they will suck both the shells in such an extent that it will be very difficult to separate them unless they decide to separate themselves. This is when a coconut shell octopus is in open before it could find a shell. So maybe the shell was little away and it became a little bit annoyed. So it posed me like this. And this is a giant octopus. Mm-hmm. And it was coming out of the hive and it saw me and could not decide whether to go inside or come outside. So in the undeciding moments, at least I could decide to click some clicks. This is one of the rare moments for me in Palauwe, the mating octopus. Octopus mating can be a very long process, and their aggressiveness and the male's aggressiveness into drag the female is a real feast to watch. Here, the dotted ones, I mean, actually, octopus, I think, you know, they can change their colors instantly. Now, if they are brown, they can become cream, they can become light yellow, and they can become spotted octopus like this. Here, you can see the male trying to drag the female for the mating. And this event, we also have a video of around 3-4 minutes where we could record the whole process of the mating. And these are the famous subjects of mine called nudibranchs. Nudibranch is the word given to them because they have absolutely no shells on their body. So that means they live nude. And it was so told that there are more than 3,000 plus series of species of nudibranchs available, and every single day there's a new thing being added. And it has been my dream to, I have now around 240 to 250 species recorded in my camera, and I hope one day at least I will, even if I could touch 4 digits in a species, I'll be one of those lucky and divers. But I had lot of movement. Particularly, there are places which are famous for nudibranchs, like Lembe in Indonesia, then Ambon in Indonesia, and there is another place called Anilaw in Philippines, and then Romblon in Philippines. They are known as macro heavens, where nudibranchs are the regular sights to watch. This is another nudibranch, and sorry, with a long gap of everything, I am missing the name. And scientific name is beyond my pronunciation also. So it will be very tough. Sorry for that, but I will show you unity branch images. This is one more one. And you can see the color. This guy, when he saw the light being flashed, he opened up the full body and posed with all the colors. Otherwise, he will get coiled up into a normal brown color. Mm-hmm. This is one more thing. And actually, Sanjit once saw this looks like a Swarovski tabletop than a nudibranch. So that's how it is. And this is a mating nudibranch, which again, this nudibranch is hardly around 2-2.5 inches in size. And finding them mating and spending some time and clicking is a real different experience altogether.
This is another porcelain clap on an anemone. Many divers' favorite subject, shipwrecks. Like, there are some areas in Koror Island where hundreds of ships from the Second World War are lying underwater to be explored. And there is a special course for the wreck diving, which teaches scuba divers how to penetrate to the wrecks without, because these wrecks can be very dangerous because the iron sharpness, like you can see some of the edges here. And if you just pass through that, you can imagine what can happen.
Right.
So shipwreck is a specialization itself. But those people who are not specialized, they will just stand aside the way my dive instructor is doing and get amazed by the ship which is lying underwater. And this is actually not my image, Hammerhead Shark. This image is courtesy of Mr. Alexander. And there is a place near Costa Rica called Galapagos. I have been told that if you go to Galapagos and hang on to, because there is something called as a drift diving or a hook dive. Like in southern Maldives, if you go, the water can take you away by 100 meters every minute. So what our dive guides do, they will guide you to 30 to 40 meters and then they will locate the dead rocks, which are not living corals. So they will, we will have special hooks and we will lock with a hook to the coral and stand for as long as our bottom time permits us. And that is when in southern Maldives, in pretty few dives, we used to count like 100, 100 and plus, 110, 120, then stop so much bored counting that you start just start imaging them. They are white tip sharks, black tip sharks, and sometimes I have seen tiger and leopard sharks also there. But like that, people can see hammerhead sharks in Galapagos. Here you are seeing few of them. Otherwise, if someone Googles hammerhead sharks in Galapagos, videos, you can see hundreds and hundreds of them every day. And people say that in Galapagos from the boat, if you dive, invariably you will land on a hammerhead shark. That is the density of the population of hammerhead sharks. And now, is it possible for your passion to drive your interest? I always feel that unless you have a passion, there is nothing called which can drive you for the interest. Because my passion for water has not what brought me here today. Today, I am proud enough to say that I have visited around 13 countries and I have visited more than 40 dive destinations and did around my last 15 days back in near Udupi Kapu, I did my 876th dive. So 876 dive for a normal Indian scuba diver is not a small figure. But of course, there are many people who Amit ji also knows and many people know who have done thousands of dives and their level is something different. But I hope I will be able to click few more hundreds. But what drives me underwater is my passion for water and my passion for photography underwater. And this is just to show you the equipments in scuba diving. This is my younger one when he was just 11 years and completed his diving. And I don't know, I could not understand his feeling even today, whether he's inquisitive to go into the water or inquisitive to pose for the camera.
Yeah, guys, look for Mr. Dheeraj Nanda on Instagram. He's an award-winning photographer. And you can see some amazing images from this father-son duo.
Yeah, and just to share one of the proud things, in 2017, his name was published in India Book of Records for maximum number of international awards in a single year. He has taken 18 awards, all first prizes in one single year, international awards. And this is something I am sure very few scuba divers in India must have done. And when he did it, he was not even 18 years.
Yeah, in fact, Nanda sir, with your permission, I'm going to do a special episode with Dheeraj.
And do. Actually, I felt that I told Mohan sir also, sir, Mohan sir, what are you talking to me? There is so much you can know from Dheeraj because his experience and his inquisitiveness and technical knowledge is several times more than me. Because I am still considered as a very bad scuba diver.
And let us not miss elder son also. Ritesh Nanda is equally good photographer and a diver.
Yeah. And Ritesh Nanda will be a better landscape and what should I say, time lapse and long exposures. He is crazy about that. So that's to tell about that. Yes, sir. And now here, just to explain people who are interested to know what is scuba diver, the scuba. Scuba word is a abbreviation for self-contained underwater breathing operators. I think many people, sir, what is scuba? Scuba is diving. Scuba. It's an abbreviation of the word self-contained underwater breathing operators. And here, this image explains you what all the basic things you need. Number one, basic thing, everybody tells. Mohan sir, you have seen my leg and many times asked me, what is this? Yes. So, in my first few hundred dives, I used to go with just my Bermuda and bare chest, like, main kuch bhi kar sakta hun, pailwan karke. So, what happened? All those corals and fungus and other things, whatever, affected my leg so much that there are a lot of black spots. So, I always advise people, never ever get into water without a wetsuit. Preferably a 3mm wetsuit. It is good for your skin. And it is good for your body metabolism also because it will help you get adjusted to the water temperature by varying the thickness of the wetsuit. And along with the wetsuit, the first important, next important thing is the BCD, which we call buoyancy container compensator device. And next is the tank and then a mask, a booty, a fin. And then comes the regulator. Now, every regulator will have two pieces. So, it is like from this pipe of the BCD, the regulator extent, where the main regulator is the black one, which will be used by the diver himself. And there is also a secondary regulator, which is called as octopus, mouthpiece. Octopus is meant for, and to tell you about the importance of octopus, scuba diving is not a hobby or sports which can be done alone unless you are certified to be a self-contained independent diver, which goes after several stages. But till then, scuba diving is always supposed to be done with a buddy. There should be at least two people to do the scuba diving. And when we go two people, if another guy has any problem and he indicates that he has a problem, and he, like for example, people like me who go out of air very often and very quickly. So I have to depend on the, like my best oxygen tank next to me is always Dheeraj if I'm diving with him. Because my tank, by the time it completes in 40 minutes, he will still have air for another 60 minutes. So out of that 60 minutes, I will take another 5-10 minutes to come up easily. So that is where the octopus comes for your rescue. This is an emergency mouthpiece. And then there will be a, like nowadays people use the computer in hand, but there are many people who use the dive computer along with their gauge. Gauge will be the thing which shows you in what, at what depth you are, and you can also have a compass there to show your direction. Along with that, you can also have a dive computer which will record all your movements underwater. And here, though people here, the gloves has been shown, but generally in scuba diving, it is advised that not to use the gloves because gloves will tempt you to touch the things which you cannot touch without gloves. So I generally feel safe without gloves because that will avoid me from touching anything. This is to tell about the scuba diving equipment. And this is the man who is this now. If okay, I am sure very few of you will know. This guy is Neil Armstrong. And why I am showing the first one and this one? Because if I ask everybody who is Neil Armstrong, everybody will say, oh, Neil Armstrong, oh, he has gone to the moon. But at the same time, if we ask 100 people, even the scuba divers, who was the first person who did the scuba diving, who invented the scuba diving, very few people know. Very few people will know. That is only to say that what is the lack of knowledge we have about a major part of the world. That's the thing. Now, talking about a major part of the world, it is not a surprise. It is now a common knowledge to all the people that 71% of the earth is covered by water, and every second breath of oxygen we breathe has to come from the oceans. But unfortunately, we know the importance, but the care given, I think less spoken is the better. And now, how much of the ocean is exported? We spent several hundred times more to know what is in other planet or what is in the sky, rather than the money to spend to know what is next to us underwater, which is more important as on today. So this is the camera gift here. And this is me with a full camera. And there is a Doom port, which is a 14 inches Doom port in lens. This will be generally used for wide angle camera. And I earlier explained about the strobes, which are connected to the main camera. And these two strobes are there, and strobes can, you can operate only one strobe, or you can operate both the strobes, or you can also increase the intensity of the light with all the buttons available. So due to lack of the time, I will not be able to explain fully. And this is the monster light, which many people call me that, agar nanda night mein dive kar raha hai toh, don't go behind him. This is a 9,000 lumen lamp, which will flood up the whole area just like that. But even in the night times, I use it in the less intensity of 1/3 because of the too much light. And this earlier, I used to have this GoPro as a standby all the time. Now I have replaced the GoPro with the Sony 4K camera. And few basic things which are required for diving, that is gear. The having a good gear is just halfway through to become a photographer. But before that, anybody who want to become a photographer, I always suggest them, be stable in the water and beware that buoyancy is very important, because particularly when you become a macro photographer, you have to rest on the ocean bottom just few inches away and then concentrate on the subject. If you are not buoyant enough, there is no way you can become a good photographer. A stable diving and a buoyant diving is very important before even thinking of catching a camera. And complete manual control on the camera is very important, because there is nothing like autofocus and auto ISO and other things. It's always good to know the controls of the lighting and nothing. And apart from that, the man behind the lens is not important. The man next to the lens is very, very important, because that local dive guides mm-hmm. who know the area, who know the problems of the area, and who know the spots, and who can take, like, Amitji, you remember once in one of the workshops, you used to tell me, Nanda, if you are going to a particular destination, Google the destination, take the screenshots of some images, and tell your local guide that these are the things which are famous in this area, and that is what you have to concentrate. That will solve 50% of your photography problem. Now, like that, in underwater also, after learning from you, I always tell people, know the location, know the life around the location, and get the perfect guide and a spotter. That will only lead you to the proper photography. And thank you, Amitji, for that. I might not have thanked you earlier. So that is a wonderful lesson you taught me. And that's it, sir. So that's all. Thank you very much.
So Nanda, sir, you showed us so much of your diving gears. How do you manage to carry it with you on your international trips or local trips?
Sir, that is where Nature Extreme has come to my rescue. Sorry, this is not a marketing thing. This is a practical thing, because the canine bag, what I regularly use for, both of you know the canine bag, the yes. canine like 500mm lens and all those things. Now, in canine, we have, all of us know the vertical suction. Now, for scuba diving, we have the horizontal suction. Now, I will make it half cut. Bottom, I will keep the housing. And above that, I will keep all the these things, doom ports and other things, and which is always on my back. And the basic, and another good news for all the scuba divers I would like to share is, there are 2-3 countries like Malaysia, Philippines, and Indonesia where scuba divers are welcome with additional luggage. Particularly if you go by Garuda Airline or Malaysian Airlines, and once you are, let us say, taking a flight from Malaysia to, particularly I will explain you, Malaysia to Australia, my luggage said, you're a scuba diver and I have to show my card and I have to show where I'm going. And they will give me, along with 30 kg, another 25 kg very easily. But unfortunately, in India, I was told that is possible only for the golf players or cricketers, but not for scuba divers or photographers. And the kind of problem we face, all photographers know. But hopefully, a day will come when they treat photographers also, that the money saved there can be useful for some more safaris in the destination.
Nanda sir, one question from my side. A guy who wanted to start learning scuba diving or diving lessons. So do we have options available in India?
Yes, sir. Actually, I missed those two slides. See, in India, there is a premier association called SSI, Scuba Schools International, which has an Indian office in Bangalore. And incidentally, Nature Extreme is also a... We have a scuba diving school in Bangalore called Natex Divers, where one can enroll for the... Like, let me start from the beginning. For example, there is a group of few people who want to experience diving before getting a proper diver. There is something called as a tri-scuba. In tri-scuba, what happens? We will take you to the water and explain you what is a BCD, what is a regulator, what is a mask, what is a fin, everything. And we will personally guide with an individual instructor and take you underwater. And we will also show you how to equalize your breathing, how to equalize the nose and how to clear the mask. And you can experience it for 25, 30 minutes with a very minimum fees of, say internationally, we call it $100. But in India, let us say it is $6,000 approximately. So that will give you an idea of what is scuba diving, what is marine life and what is sea.
Yeah, my second question based on this is, suppose if I have a camera, do we have these cases and all available on the rental things?
In India, no, sir.
Okay.
But there are very few, like for example, I am associated with a dive company in Malaysia, mm-hmm. where we can arrange for the, like for example, someone wants to come with, let us say 1DX, or 1D Mark C, which is totally for video, and he know how to handle it, and he's a scuba diver. So there is a premier association where which can rent out the housing and other things. Cost will be exorbitant, but the purpose will be served. Like sure. In India now, we are getting into a situation where my office has four sets of TGCs, mm-hmm. which we will rent to people.
Super.
So that when you go on the first day, of course, when people try to go for tri-scuba with me, I'll make it a point not to click the fish, but click the human fish around me and give them some memorable photos. But yeah. Once they're done, you can take the camera and rent a camera for a day or two and then get accustomed.
Guys, those who are watching, I'm going to share all the links in the description below about the Nature Extreme, how to contact Nanda and Sanjit sir, and you can get in touch with them. Okay, so with this, thank you, Nanda sir, for joining and clearing some basic doubts on the underwater world. You are not shown us more than 10% of your entire portfolio. But
sorry for that, because I think I already taken more than 1 hour, 1 hour, 10 minutes, though I said it will be less than an hour.
And Nanda sir, definitely I'm going to share some links in the description so that people can contact you if they have these.
Please, sir, that would be so nice of you.
Yeah, super.
So anybody, anything about scuba diving, we are there. And Nature Extreme is not just a scuba diving thing. We are quite professional in handling. See, Nature Extreme, why we call this company as Nature Extreme is, we are proudly, I will say that we are the only company or one of those very, very few companies in the world who can show you a snow leopard at 17,000 feet or a whale shark at 40 feet below the water with anything else on land. Sure. So we are there in the mountains, land and water. That is Nature Extreme for us.
So thank you, Nanda sir, so much for your time and being here, and wish you, Sanjit sir, and Natex all the best. Thanks for all your support, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. It's a privilege of is all mine that you considered me to be worth to be in this big elite group of people who are showcasing their talents. Thank you so much. Look forward for many more legends to give their interviews. Actually, I'm proud to say that I'm group what you have made is not just a YouTube channel, but this is a knowledge bank in itself for many people like me who want to know or who are always on the quest of knowledge.
Yeah. In fact, Nanda sir, I'm sure after this episode, there will be a lot of questions and queries will come. And based on that, I might have a Q&A session with you in near future.
Sure, sir. Anytime.
Sure. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Amitji. Thank you, Mohan, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.